How many of you know about Yodlee, by the way? Show of hands. Not bad. Okay. Oh, of course you guys know. So I have a whole bunch of team members here. And yeah. Okay. So I'm not going to start for another couple of minutes, but this is just a warm up. So my vocal cords, you know, get warmed up, and we have a good conversation. I have 45 minutes for this talk, but what I typically like to do is have it a two-way conversation. I mean, the content that I have, you know, I was preparing it till a minute ago, and that's about anywhere from 15 minutes to 5 hours of conversation that we can have around those 45 slides. And so what I would really like for this to be not a one-way channel, especially because we've all had some very good lunch. So I will pause, you know, whenever you want me to pause, and you know, if there are comments that you have, not just questions, if there are comments that you would like to make on, you know, what I'm talking about, it's more than welcome. I know Rohit will have a lot to say, so Rohit, please stop me. As well of, you know, similarly my team here from Yodlee, if you have any comments, if you think I made a mistake, you know, please call it out. Likewise, if you guys want a particular thing to be covered, you all, I'm guessing, read the abstract. So if you have any expectation of what should be covered, what is less important, please let me know, and then, you know, we can do that also. Yeah. Okay. Is it time? Yeah. Okay. So thank you everybody for showing up. I am Om Deshmukh. I am a senior director. I run data sciences for Yodlee. And so what I wanted to do today was talk about this lengthy topic, which essentially says, how do you take a machine learning solution which does a wonderful job in a lab setting and actually deploy it so that somebody pays for it? That's essentially the point of the talk. Yeah. Okay. So before I go into the talk, I thought I'll give you some context of who I am, what you should expect in the next 45 minutes, and what sort of a color I'm going to bring to this talk based on my background. So I have a PhD in machine learning as it is applied to speech recognition. This was about 12 years ago. And then I was in a couple of industry research labs where I think I had a good chance of working with wonderful team members, which led to good, you know, good recognition in the research community in terms of research papers, patents, a lot of best paper awards, and so on. But then about 2.5 years ago, I made a big switch based on this background. And then the other thing that got added to my introduction is the following, which says delivered in live production, which means it is live. Any change that you make gets, you know, is visible almost instantaneously. A deep data science solution, which means it's not just rules, it's not just, you know, a simplistic model, but it's a deep data science model, which is at scale, which means today, one of the solutions that we have runs on about a few tens of million unstructured text transactions, financial transactions. And there are strict, very strict SLAs. So these tens of millions of transactions have to be processed within an hour or two. Otherwise, people who are paying may not want to pay. So all of this we've been able to deliver. And, you know, I'll talk about what were the challenges in moving from this part to this part. So that's the focus of the talk. What I also wanted to say was, you know, while I spent about 10 odd years in this field, or 10 odd years here and 5 odd years there, I like to believe that I know maybe, you know, hopefully 1% of machine learning, whatever machine learning exists, and maybe less than 1%. But the good news is that is enough, actually more than enough, to be able to deliver this kind of stuff, where you can have at scale, real-time, highly stringent SLA-based solutions which are, you know, which are truly big data and truly valuable for people to the extent that they will pay for it. So that's sort of one message that I want to get across. Okay, any questions, comments? No. Okay. I've also been lucky enough to have in all of my career so far wonderful team members. Some of them are sitting here. Please raise your hands. So if there are questions after the talk, you know, you all can, and if I'm not available, you can talk to these guys. Okay. Now, as we move from, you know, from developing a POC within a relatively closed, relatively secure environment, and you deploy it, the first thing you have to worry about are who are my stakeholders, right? And folks who join late, the comment that I made earlier is, these are my views. If you have not just a question, but a comment where you want to challenge this or you want to support it, please feel free. I want to have this as a, you know, as a conversational event rather than one way where I keep talking. Yeah. Okay. So who are the main stakeholders? The first one is, of course, the data science team. And so I'm guessing many of you here have had some interaction with a data scientist or are yourself a data scientist. So when a data scientist builds a solution, what is the first thing that he would say? Folks in Yodlee, please don't speak. Any guesses? Like, what is the first instinctive thing that a data scientist would say?
How soon we can go into production?
No.
I got this much accuracy.
Thank you. Exactly. He's going to say, I am using this cool technology, which gives me, you know, 95% accuracy. And I did that. I mean, in the beginning of my career, I used to be highly, you know, boastful about the accuracy that I'm getting about a particular solution, which definitely wasn't 100%, but still, right? Now, who is the other stakeholder? The customer-facing teams, right? And what is their first, what's their first instinct? So they have what I call, I totally came up with this term, Sachin Tendulkar expectation syndrome. What that means is every time Sachin comes to bat, the first ball has to be a six, and he should not get out till he hits a century, right? And so they have this kind of a syndrome which says, no matter what the solution is, no matter what the expectation is, it has to be 100% accurate. Anything less than 100% is not acceptable at all. So that's the second big stakeholder that you need to manage. Which is the third stakeholder in this case? It's the executive team. They always, you know, always worry, are we missing the bus? There's a new cool technology that has come out. Are we using it? Is there value for, you know, for us to be using that technology and so on, right? And so what we've been doing, how we are managing this is, I am, of course, largely focused on this side. I have a lot of experience here. One thing that has worked wonderfully for us so far, at least, is helping the data science team get a full picture of what is the problem they are trying to solve. Why is 99% not good enough in some cases? Why is 83% just about enough in some other cases, and so on? And it has worked wonders, giving the data science world a full picture of the problem they are solving really, really helps them to step up, as well as for a different kind of solution to emerge out of this. The second thing is, give them freedom to explore cool things. A lot of the times what happens is, as you're exploring cool things, a new solution comes out which is applicable to the problem that business is willing to pay for. So folks who were there in yesterday's talk that some of my team members gave, we talked about a lot of the work in reinforcement learning. There's a tiny piece of that we are actually using for our work, but a whole lot of work that is happening there really has only peripheral application to what we are doing. So that's sort of the cool work that we're bringing in here. Okay. Then on this side, really, there is just educate the customer facing teams in terms of how the data science world works, how it is different from a typical software development world. Offer to collaborate. I'll talk a little bit about that, and then educate a little more and keep doing this till you hit a winning strategy. And then, of course, on the exec side, to a large extent, it's education, as well as talking about the data cycle world. What I mean by that is the following. And again, you know, all the images are from Google search. I just knew what to search for. I didn't build these images. So what we are seeing is rich gets richer. And what I wanted to highlight in this picture is each of these points on the circle are comparative words. It's more or smarter or better. It doesn't, what that means to me, at least, it wasn't in the actual article that had this. What it means to me is, you can start in this circle at any point. For example, it doesn't say X users or X accuracy algorithm. You can start at any point, and as you go around the circle, you will get better and better and better, right? Eventually though, what I feel, and this is my point of view, after a while, as the machine learning systems become, you know, a lot more stable than what it is today, more data will be the main differentiator. And notice that I'm not using a quantitative word in terms of what that more means. It's a qualitative word. And I'll talk a little bit about what data really means and what more really means in this case. Yeah. Okay. And the second one is, how do you educate the elusive 100%? Right? I mean, Google has been around for many, many years. They're undoubtedly the best in terms of search and a lot of other machine learning, deep machine learning work that happens. But when you search for Jaguar, let's say you got this, how many of you believe this is correct? I was expecting a lot more of you to say it, but okay. It depends, exactly, right? So if you were expecting this, then this is the correct one, right? Now, maybe you really meant Jaguar and you just got the spelling wrong. Even then you're going to yell at Google that it didn't find the faucet that you're looking for. So that's sort of, you know, why even big mighty groups do not have 100% accuracies, right? So it depends on how you define 100% really. Right. The only place where it fails is if you make a mistake like this. If you search for Jaguar and you gave an output or gave a result which is this. I mean, and those are the kind of things that shouldn't happen. If they happen and you get yelled at, yes, you deserved it. But otherwise, 100% can be not just the exact 100%, but something else. Okay. The second point is consumer AI versus enterprise AI. What I mean by this is, when you go to Facebook or any of your social media or, you know, any of the other services which are actually free, your expectations are high, yes, but the fallout of a wrong output is not as bad. For example, you took your wife out for a movie. The review said it was a highly romantic movie. It turned out to be an action film. Okay. You know, I mean, it's not as bad. Yes, you will go hungry for a couple of days, but probably not as bad as what may happen in this case, when the stakes are much higher. So there are a couple of examples that I would like to give. One, sorry?
The trading sort of things that you give.
Yes. So there was one example where some machine learning algorithm misfired only for 15 minutes, just 15 minutes of one day in one trading platform. And that led to a loss of about $400 million. That's huge, right? I mean, that's really huge. Other example is some image recognition software misfired, and a lady who is innocent was stopped, held at gunpoint, because her number plate was misrecognized as of somebody else who was most wanted. And so those are the kind of enterprise AI problems that you need to solve, where the customer facing teams really have a lot of pressure when they're talking to the customers, and hence the kind of things that work or don't work on the consumer AI side need not necessarily work there, right? Okay. So then what that means is you need a lot more holistic approach. That says you need an end-to-end solution that a customer is willing to pay for. You have to be crystal clear what is the exact value that the AI solution is bringing, and then be able to call it out saying it'll do this, the rest of it is outside of its purview. That is where your internal stakeholders will be very, very appreciative if you're able to call that out. And then, of course, this piece is, and we've had to struggle with this quite a bit, not just in the current setup, but also, you know, in some of the research labs, where you can't optimize all three things. You can't optimize cost, can't optimize accuracy, and can't optimize functionality. It's like you have to hold, if you hold two of them constant, the third one has to move for it to, you know, for it to be feasible. Okay, so how are decisions typically made, made before this, before the emergence of big data? Do you know this concept called HIPAA, highest paid person's opinion, HIPPO, sorry, yeah? Typically, that is what used to happen, and for a rightful reason, because intuition was largely what would drive decisions, And intuition would come as you got more and more experience. And as you got more and more experience, you would, you know, hopefully get higher and higher paid. So Hippo was, you know, was a reasonably good way of doing things in the pre-data environment, right? Now what happens is the Hippo person or the person who is, you know, in the position of authority to make a decision should only be able to formulate one or more hypotheses.
Yeah.
And then that person or that group, before getting into driving the action, has to go through these steps, where figure out what is the data that is needed to evaluate these hypotheses. I'm not saying validate, but evaluate, right? How do we get these data sets? Whether they are available in the current setup or not, what is the time taken to get them, and you know, all sorts of questions which I'll dig deeper in a little while. The third is, what are the ways in which we can now formulate insights based on this data, right? And then only provide expert interpretation of that data. What that also means, okay, I forgot about this, good. Yeah. What that also means is, look at the data, keep your biases aside for a minute, and make a decision. The other very important interpretation of this is, do not let data or machine learning alone make the decision. There has to be human in the loop. It's very, very important. Yeah. Okay, so these are sort of 9 steps that we have come up with. This is by no means the final thing, and definitely by no means the correct thing. We are working on this, so any inputs that you have would be highly appreciated. One is, of course, know exactly what problem to solve. I'll talk a little bit about this. Where is the data? What are the limitations? What are the ways in which you can scrub the data? What is the AI/ML framework that you can use? Data swimming, this is something that we came up with, which basically just says, you know your data intimately before you can even make any predictions. I'll talk a little bit about that. Represent the data so that it can be used by your machine learning setup. Train for generalization. I'll talk a little bit about this. Optimize for deployment, and then know what is the end-to-end thing. What are the touch points with your customer? Definitely, the customer is not interacting with your machine learning solution in its raw form. There is some transformation that is happening. There is some interface that the user is interacting with, right? And then, of course, provide feedback. So I'm not going to cover all these 9 steps. I'm going to cover the AI/ML aspect, and then these 2 aspects. Swimming is a very abstract thing. That by itself will take about 45 minutes. But I'll talk a little bit about that, you know, as we progress.
One question on this first one, like, we know exactly which problem to solve, but like from the business perspective, most of the time it is about the revenue generation.
Yes. So the question was, this problem really is only one line, get me more money.
Yes,
of course. But the problem is, that is the business problem. So I like to say that a good researcher is somebody who solves a given problem. A great researcher is somebody who formulates the right problem. And so this is really the first piece, where you need a good team which can take this business problem, which is, you know, increase my revenue, either my top line or bottom line, formulate that into a functional problem. What does that mean? Do I have to build a UI? Do I have to increase the time, reduce the time that it takes, or do I need to get higher accuracy? And then formulate that into a data-driven problem. So at Yodlee, we call this as the discovery phase, which means when an internal customer comes to us and says, solve this problem, we say, we'll first discover. And what does that discovery mean? A, is the problem solvable from a data perspective or not? Which means, A, are there patterns? Is a human able to solve it? Do we have enough data? So that's one. Second is, do we have the kind of infrastructure that we need to solve that problem? Or is the infrastructure cost much, much more than the kind of money that we would make? And then at the end of it, unless the answer for both of these is yes, discovery phase ends by saying, no, this problem is not solvable. We will not solve it, at least not in a data-driven way. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. What we also used to do back in some of our research labs was we would have dreaming sessions with our clients. We would sit with them and have them tell us what are their pain points, how is it that they're currently solving it, and so on. Yeah. That touches upon a little bit of the data swimming part. But before getting the data, we're trying to figure out, you know, what is the lay of the land, and so on. There was a question? Right. Yes. Yes. Okay. So the question was, a lot of the times business teams come to the data science group and says, I know exactly what problem to be solved. Here's the data. Go solve it. Right. And how do you address this? The way you address this is not a technical conversation. It's more of a soft skill kind of a conversation where you either have to, one of those, yes. Sorry, I shouldn't be making fun of that question. It is a very important question. But what I'm trying to say is there is no one direct way of answering it. A couple of things that have worked out well for me over the past 10 odd years is A, although I'm a teetotaler, I take them out, have a conversation largely so they trust you. So they know that this guy knows what he's talking about or his team knows what they're doing and they'll open up. A, that's one. B is be genuine and ask them probing questions of what will happen when you solve this problem. And that has also worked out very well for us, where we take the problem, but then we ask them genuinely, okay, why do you think solving this problem will lead to the customer either upselling or cross-selling or buying a new thing? And that has, sort of worked out for us. Yeah.
You might be dealing with, say, an IT person, whereas the real problem is at the business end, and the IT person doesn't have access to the, the full data or the full cooperation from the business side. So they want to show something that's possible to the business side before really taking you the full way. That's one thing I've seen. The other thing I've seen is maybe they're just trying to give you a small problem as a test problem to see how good you are. So I've seen those things. And the best really address it is to really figure out why, they're trying to restrict the scope. And based on that, figure out, how to approach it.
Right. Yeah. Yes. So that is definitely a challenge. Events like this, where not just the data scientists but a lot of business facing teams would come, are great places for this kind of awareness to be spread. Yes, absolutely. Okay. So I was going to also skip this or largely gloss over what is the ideal data and so on. Skip that part and come to the fourth one, which is how do you formulate the framework, the AI ML framework that you want to look at. This is really a very difficult problem to solve. There is no textbook solution to this kind of a problem. This will come through extensive training in the area of data sciences. So, for example, basic things like knowing what regularization will work for me, what kind of a model will work for me, which models are applicable for text data, which models are applicable for multimodal data, and so on. It's not something that is tangible that I can put my hand on and say, go follow these five steps and you will get the answer. Although I'll give you some ideas into this. The other problem that we have seen is there are two extremes. One extreme is good data science papers, which talk about how an algorithm works, what is the maths behind it, but won't necessarily go into which areas it is applicable, what are the nuances. So, for example, if you take a KDD paper or an IPS paper and try to implement it, you will definitely not get the accuracy that they got, because there are a lot of things that are not talked about, and rightfully because the The paper is only X pages and you can't talk about all the things. So I'll cover a little bit of that here. The important thing that it has to be worried about in an enterprise big data setup is your solution has to be generalizable and it has to be scalable. I'll give you some ideas on how it has worked out for us. Okay, so, and this sort of also ties with how you need to now, you know, manage your stakeholders. Typically what happens, and this is just a schematic, of course, taken from Google search, whatever resource you've expended, this initial foundational work really is the crucial effort. Because after a while, it hits an asymptote. And that asymptote really depends on this. Now, it's true about a software development setup also, but not as much. Because in a software development setup, once you fix the API handshake that I'll give you X inputs, I'll get Y outputs, pretty much the work is done, then that black box can be used wherever you want and there is no cascading effect, if you will. But in the machine learning setup, that's not the case. What you do in the foundational layer, so for example, somebody gave you data, you had to fit a model to it and you thought for whatever reason it's a third order polynomial, you fit it, you spent a lot of time doing that. As you get more and more data, no matter how many efforts you put, you have reached that asymptote. You have to go back, critically evaluate whether the third order polynomial was the right thing to do or not. And that sort of brings you back to square one. But then, when you hit the asymptote, either you hit it much early or you hit it at a much higher value. Yeah? So that's why it's very important that it has irreversible impact on when you hit it and where you hit it. So it's very important that the foundational part is given a lot of time, a lot of due diligence. Okay, so broadly speaking, in that foundational layer, you need to think about two things. One is the subjectivity, which will come into your models. And the second is the objectivity. And what are the ways in which you can control those? Again, there is no deep data science in this, but these are things that typically get not discussed as much. So the main objectivity that comes into your machine learning model is the cost function. How are you penalizing the loss function or whatever? How are you penalizing your machine, right? And there are a variety of ways and variety of cost functions that you can use. I have just given three very simple ones. A linear function. So the x-axis is what is the deviation from the expected output? And the y-axis is for that deviation, how much are you penalizing the machine? So the linear function, stepwise function, and then some sort of a piecewise linear or mixed function. Now what does linear say? Any small deviation from this point gets proportionately penalized. So the machine is now being made to learn that everything has to be exactly the same in the output as what I saw in the input. That's not always a good thing. Because sometimes you want to have some leeway so the machine can learn some generalizable solutions, right? So any small deviation is penalized. Stepwise functions typically would be that rounding off errors are okay. And if that's okay with your problem, if your business unit is okay with that, your customers are okay with that, then maybe that is the function that you should be following, right? Again, these are all sort of obvious things, but in the rush of the moment, a lot of the times when you're looking at some cool algorithm, these things take a back seat and then they come back to bite you, later. The third is, of course, the mixed function. If you are tolerant to a particular limit, and if the business says that, or you yourself believe from the domain experts that you have that that's okay, then maybe that's the function that you want to use. Or the reverse is also possible, that you used a function like this, and then you realize that a lot of the a lot of the negative publicity you got was in this region that you thought was tolerant, and it's not. It's time to go change your loss function. Okay. That's sort of the one aspect of objectivity. The second is the subjectivity piece. The machine is only as accurate as the data that is fed to it. I mean, it can generalize, yes, but still some of the things that it learns are based on what is being fed to the system. And so in this case, if the machine has to distinguish between red and green, it's easy for humans who are giving the labeled data for the system to provide highly accurate data, right? And so that in a typical supervised setup, you would have, you know, some human or some expert giving you some inputs like this. The kind of things that you would want to do are repeatability and reproducibility. What I mean by repeatability is the same task is given to the same human expert at two different times, and then you see how much is the agreement for that same task, same human, but across two different times. That tells you about the complexity and the subjectivity of the task. Reproducibility is the same task is now given to two different experts who are in the same setup. So there is no external, you know, ambient variations that are coming in. Same setup, two different human experts, same problem. How many times do they agree? That is what is reproducibility. That gives you an upper limit for what to expect from the training data that you're getting. That'll also tell you how much generalizability you want to bring in. One way of doing that is changing your regularizer and so on. So those are the kind of things that you need to worry about. As the task gets complex, you know, like saying whether it's a navy blue color or dark blue or violet, humans themselves are going to be, you know, a little more confused than in the previous case. And hence, it's reasonable to expect for a machine to be also, you know, a lot more confused than when the task is simple. So you have to be very particular about these things. What that also means is that when you are posing the ML problem to get the, you know, get the data, be it through your in-house teams which do the labeling for you, or through any of the crowdsource platforms, you have to be crystal clear about the kind of problem that you are posing. Yeah. In literature, it's also called priming. How you prime the user to provide feedback,
label.
Yes, that has a lot of influence on the kind of label that you would get. Yeah. Okay. Now comes the domain expert and flexibility piece. Let's say I gave you only this data, some x-axis, some y-axis, and I, you know, gave you this data points, and I said you fit a model to it. You know, a reasonable person would say, okay, I'll do a linear model. Which is a reasonable thing to do. Occam's razor, whatever is the simplest, let's just use that, and in this case, this happens. Now, let's say a domain expert comes in and says, wait a minute, the x-axis is really the magnetic field intensity. The y-axis is the amount of magnetization that you have. And so now, would you do a linear? Probably not, because now the human expert has told you that there is going to be some saturation that is going to happen. You haven't seen the data yet, but tomorrow or, you know, soon you will see that data. And now, because of that human expert feedback that you've gotten instantly, you would now say, okay, I'll do a piecewise linear model. Right? So that's where a lot of synergy has to come in from the human experts. We have seen a lot of the times data scientists go off to the extreme and say, we don't need any human experts. There is this cool latest paper that has been published. It's given 99% accuracy. I'm just going to blindly use it. Oftentimes, it will fail. Now, you know, extending this magnetic theory data, a lot of the times, what you would see is that the data may completely shift in the n-dimensional space that you're looking at, where a human expert either is a little late to come and tell you, or the human expert himself or herself wasn't sure how the data is going to, how it's going to change in this whole dynamic world. So there what you need is flexibility in the model. Because as you see more data, your model has to be flexible so that it can systematically incorporate the new data that has been seen. And somebody just before the talk began was asking me about what I thought was transfer learning kind of a problem, where the data that you saw for training wasn't necessarily the kind of data that you were getting in testing. A lot of flexibility that you would get from model building, the kind of model that you would use, will provide for the generalizability. And I'll talk a little bit about some of the work we're doing in that area. So that flexibility problem, let me motivate it slightly differently also. How many clusters do you see here, typically? Two, right? Okay. As you add more data, I don't know if you noticed that, but I added a little more data, and you still see this 2. Remember, you fixed K to 2, right? Okay, I at least saw people nodding their heads for 2. Now what happens? Now there was more data, which sort of came here. It came here. Now at least half of the people who earlier said K was equal to 2 was absolutely right. are probably, if not outright saying no, it's not two, at least are in the doubtful region that K may not be two in this case, right? Now, what would a typical machine learning person do? Okay, I'll change from K equal to 2 to K equal to 5 or 4 and rerun the entire thing. Now, that's okay if you have million samples. If you have billions of samples and, you know, somebody is charging you for the kind of hardware that you're going to use, you will definitely think twice, right? And that's where you now need to go back and see how humans do it and what are the kind of machine learning techniques that can be done. So a kid sees this, that's the first vehicle he or she sees there are three tires, but knows it's a vehicle. Gradually sees there are two wheels and still it's a vehicle, same category as this. In his or her mind has formed two clusters. Sees this, doesn't say this is not a vehicle, knows it's still a vehicle, but a third cluster of vehicle. Then sees this eventually or after a while, and then now doesn't say that this is not a vehicle, says, okay, you know, I initially thought one cluster, two cluster, three cluster, four. Very systematically, a human has learned this, right? They can self-teach flexibility of parameters. There is a machine learning framework which is called Bayesian non-parametrics, which helps you, 10 minutes? Yeah, thank you. There is a setup called Bayesian non-parametrics. Actually, non-parametrics is a misnomer. It is just going from a rigid set of parameters to hyperparameters, which then let you, you know, play around with the kind of values that parameters can take. Some of the popular techniques there are GPs, CRP, and IBP. The names are very odd, but those are some really cool things that you can do. If you don't know the number of clusters that your data is going to have, CRP is the technique to use. If you don't know the kind of correlation that your two data points are going to have, GP is the technique to use. If you don't know the number of dimensions that a particular data set is going to be separable at, then IBP is the technique to use. Okay, so people know about PCAs and SVDs and all of those. In those techniques, you have to know beforehand how many dimensions you're going to overlay your data in, right? Now, what happens if the dimensions which are discriminating will change or will increase, typically increase as the amount of data increases? You don't have a way of knowing what that dimension is beforehand, right, to decide what is the dimensionality at which you're going to project your data. And so that is where IBPs would come in, which would allow you to do countably infinite. So both words are very important, countable as well as infinite. It lets you go up to countably infinite number of dimensions. And similarly in CRPs, it lets you go up to countably infinite number of clusters. Of course, there are ways in which it's still bounded. It definitely never reach even twice the order of magnitude that you started with. Okay, so we do quite a bit of work in CRP and GP to adjust for dynamic nature of data. Okay, generalizability. So I'm going to skip the other steps. Sorry, I'm not covering data swimming. Generalization and optimized deployment. Yeah, okay. So, folks in my team know that no talk that Ohm gives is complete without a power law figure. So, when you handcraft rules, they are sufficient for, you know, the head of the data, the most commonly occurring data, because they're only tangible or, you know, countable number of samples. You know, you can form rules and fine. But the real value, the real money is here, where you want to have generalizability, so that you can get to the long tail as quickly and as extensively as you can. And that's the problem called exploring the long tail. How efficiently can you? Netflix has this. I mean, everybody who has the big data has this problem. YouTube has it. Google has it. How do you recommend a YouTube video that nobody has seen? You don't even know he or she will like it or not. But at the same time, you don't want to goof up too much. So that's the problem of exploring the long tail. And that's really the generalizability aspect. There are ways in which you can do this. Again, in our setup, we've come up with some ways of doing this. Now, the computational efficiency piece. Netflix gave $1 million award for, you know, the group that came up with the best way of recommending DVDs, right? Turns out they did not use that solution. This is not the only reason, actually, to be fair. This was one of the reasons, but a very important reason, that the engineering costs were just prohibitive. The other reason was they moved from DVDs to streaming and so on. But still, this highlights the kind of problem that you would have. That the solution is wonderful, data science has done an excellent job, but it's not deployable because it's cost prohibitive. And that's where, again, what we have done is figured out ways in which you can balance the complexity of the data, of the model, with the generalizability or the spread of the data that you have. Right? So what I mean by that is, in hindsight, it is very, very obvious. You have data for prediction. Instead of calling the machine learning model every time the data comes in, if there is a power law like this, and law of large numbers says that there will always be a power law, why not do this? If it is not seen before, only then call the machine learning algorithm. If it is seen, the first time it is seen, make a decision whether it should be added into a relatively cheap lookup database. And there are some way, different ways in which you can formulate this problem. If you add it, next time the data comes, if it is present in your database, it's an O1 operation of lookup. Now, of course, you're paying for the cost of RAM, you're paying for the cost of, RAM or any other kind of memory that you want to do. But that is the kind of engineering, big data engineering evaluation, critical evaluation that has to happen when you want to make the solution feasible. It also helps you a lot of the times in meeting your SLAs. Because O1 operation, you can increase the RAM size relatively easily. And get the lookups done quickly rather than having the complex algorithm be called over and over again. Yeah. Okay, so that's again these are the kind of things that don't typically get talked in any paper. Yes. Yes, good point. So the question was, or the comment was, what happens when the context changes? Absolutely. So that was the ninth block that I had in the steps, feedback loop. This assumes that the context hasn't changed. The machine learning model hasn't changed. If the context changes, but if the machine learning model hasn't learned a new thing, then the output is still going to remain the same. So when the context changes, you need a feedback loop that says the context has changed, the model has to be retrained, and then the lookup table has to be changed. Absolutely, yes. Okay, now, 5 more minutes? Yeah, okay. So now I'll talk about the UI UX part. You have to know that this is just a part of the whole system. The AI solution that you're working on is just a part. It's not, of course, not the whole thing. A lot of the times, it's a tiny piece. And so what you need is the UI UX to be such that it minimizes the exposure of your weak points. And the big guys do this very well, right? So I'll give you an example. You searched for the Prime Minister of India on Google. Now, Google is highly confident about it. So it gave you the answer right away. Right? Now, I searched for where do the MPs of India meet. We all know it's the parliament. But of course, Google wasn't very accurate or very confident. And so I said, OK, I'm not going to give the one answer and sort of create a foot in the mouth situation. I'll give all the possible answers. Or I'll just give 100,000 different searches. And how many do we have here? Yeah, we have quite a few. I mean, of course, they are ranked nicely, and the first one is the correct answer, and so on. But what I'm trying to highlight is that the interface accounts for the confidence that the machine learning system has. This also works out wonderfully in the spell correct kind of software. If it's a word like TEH, then it automatically corrects to THE. It won't even ask you. If it's something like this, and I created this morning on my laptop, visit place, it has a reasonable confidence that it is visit/place, so it recommends that. Now I do this, it has no confidence, and so instead of creating a bad impression, it says, I give up, I'm not going to make any suggestions. Right? So that's where the UI UX has very wonderfully gelled with the machine learning algorithm, the end goal that was in mind. Yeah. Okay. Now, sort of self-advertising. What are we doing with this kind of work? Right. I'm going to show you some examples of the descriptions that would come up when you swipe your credit card or you do any kind of a financial transaction. This says you purchased something in Chicago, Illinois in a Walmart. This says you went to Walmart again, WM. This says you went, did something on PayPal. This says you used PayPal to pay to a merchant called Parkmobile. This is slightly interesting, although it may look like, you know, you went to Walmart for Walmart shopping, but no, you went to Walmart to really go to the H&R block, which is a tax, you know, tax related service. This is Hulu merchant. Now again, if you had only a keyword, which was HULU, it would misfire here because there is a small grocery, which is called Chuhulota. And so just a HULU kind of a keyword based thing will misfire. And so these are all real problems and so on. The kind of work that I talked about, we've applied it to millions of these transactions with two goals, largely two goals in mind. One is predict the merchant. Second is to predict that this transaction is related to tax, category of tax. This is category of transportation because it's more parking. This is related to general merchandise because Walmart gives you general merchant, general things that you would like to buy. And so now with a baseline, which is also deep learning based baseline, the accuracy for categorization was about 88%. It went to about 93%. We got the scale in the merchants. Initially, there were only about 2,000 odd merchants in the baseline setup. And with some of the nine steps that I talked about, we are able to get to 3 million merchants. So our setup can now take any such transaction and predict a merchant if it is one of the 3 million merchants that we have, right? And hence the population has gone up. But at the same time, and that's the beauty of the system, that the population went up, but the accuracy for all of those merchants has also gone up from 76 to 92. So it's two things, right? The population goes up, and on that bigger population, the accuracy has also gone up. Okay, so that's what I had. Okay, thank you. Yeah. So the question was, would the transaction, while it has the name of the merchant, would it have the category also, MasterCard and Visa card? Sometimes we have the MCC code, which is a proxy for, largely a proxy for the categories. By and large, we don't have it. So we still have to predict. Does that answer your question?
I thought that MasterCard and Visa
MCC, not always. Okay, I think we can only take one or two more questions. Yeah. Right. So when if it is not seen, yes, by definition and by design, it will not go in the lookup. But what is, so let's say, let's take example of face recognition. Let's say there are some, it's a train station which has employees coming in and it has strangers coming in. And so you have a face recognition software there. Now you know that there are 1,000 employees who come in every day. You probably do not want them to be recognized through the face recognition software every time they walk in. You can probably create a lookup for those, you know, at some parameterized level so that when those parameters meet, it becomes a lookup. But then for the strangers, which is the long tail, you will have millions of people coming in on a monthly or an annual basis. There the lookup won't help. So that's sort of the decisioning that you need to make. This is probably the last question, I guess.
Yes.
Yeah.
Generally, we have issues with deep learning that we cannot explain the model. It's a black box model.
Right.
So in case when you have to explain it to the client, let's say you want to explain to them why this has happened. Like one thing which we have tried before was to use a deep learning network to create feature engineering and then use the feature engineering to a tree model and do the predictions so that you can explain some part of both. You get both of both. So in your case, if you have to do something like this where you have to explain a very high accuracy model, which you cannot basically get through a tree model or something.
Right.
What do you do?
So we actually have that problem. So we are working on building interpretability in the data, in the deep learning setup. So I won't have the time to go into the details of it, but what we are doing is, I mean, you can imagine a deep learning setup as multiple layers and multiple units at each layer. We are trying to figure out that when a particular output was predicted, which path triggered with what confidence. And then that path tells us that there is some association of that particular path with a particular set of characters. And then in this case, for example, yeah, sure. I'll just finish this thought. If the prediction was Hulu and the path triggered this, then we know that these were the words, these were the letters that triggered it. And that's the interpretability. Yeah. I know it's very vague, but we can talk offline. Okay, thank you so much.